Hi everyone, this is Charles Gaba of ACASignups.net. Today I want to talk about stools. Not this type of stool, or this type of stool, or even this type of stool, but the three-legged stool. When it comes to the Affordable Care Act, I've written a lot about the so-called three-legged stool in the individual health insurance market, but it's been scattered across a bunch of posts, so I'm bringing it all together into a single video, which I hope will explain why it exists, how it's supposed to work, how it's actually working, or not, and how congressional Republicans keep trying to do everything except fix it. So, first of all, who is in the individual market? Well, what you're looking at right now is something a friend of mine dubbed the psychedelic donut. It's actually a depiction of the healthcare coverage by type of the entire U.S. population, all 320 million or so of us. In this video, I'm not talking about the employer market, which makes up almost half the population when you include the military. I'm also not discussing people on Medicare or Medicaid, even including the 15 million or so covered by the ACA's expansion of Medicaid. And finally, I'm not talking about people covered through programs like the Indian Health Service, university plans for students, or so-called Christian sharing ministries. The three-legged stool is about the individual market, people who buy private health insurance policies for themselves and their families, either through the ACA exchanges like healthcare.gov or directly from an insurance carrier. A couple million of these are enrolled in grandfathered or transitional policies that date back to before ACA regulations went into effect, and about 800,000 in New York and Minnesota are enrolled in something called the Basic Health Program. But for the most part, about 15 million of them are in ACA-compliant policies, either on or off the ACA exchanges. That's who this is about. Okay, so before the ACA, the individual healthcare market was pretty much the Wild West in terms of insurance regulations. Some states had more oversight than others, but for the most part, insurance companies could deny coverage to anyone they wanted to based on pre-existing conditions, or they might let them buy a policy but charge them insanely higher premiums for doing so. They might cover stuff like mental illness, prescription drugs, maternity care, and so on, or they might not. They might cover a huge chunk of their expenses, or hardly anything at all. Basically, it was all over the place, with confusing paperwork, gotcha fine print, hidden charges, and so on. Some policies were fairly comprehensive, but many pretty much sucked and barely covered anything. Also, lots of policies had annual or lifetime limits on maximum claims, often in the range of a couple million dollars. This may sound like a lot of money, and it is, but if you're undergoing chemotherapy or have a premature baby in the neonatal unit, you could eat up your lifetime limit in a matter of months. Overall, sure, policies were relatively inexpensive, but that's because they could cherry-pick their customers and put heavy restrictions on benefits. When an insurance company only has to cover people who they're pretty sure won't cost much to cover, of course it's easy to keep prices low. As a result, millions of people found themselves literally uninsurable at any price, and millions more found out the hard way at the worst possible time that their supposedly decent health insurance policy was anything but that. The ACA hoped to fix most of these problems while also getting as many people covered as possible. So the first thing the ACA did was require that anyone be allowed to buy any given healthcare policy. No more discrimination against people with pre-existing conditions. This is called guaranteed issue. Related to this, the carriers could no longer discriminate against people based on their medical condition or gender by charging more for the same policy. This is known as community rating. The only price variations that are allowed are age, a 3-to-1 range, which is down from 5 or 6-to-1 before the ACA, where they live, and whether they smoke or not. The ACA also requires that every qualified healthcare plan cover 10 essential health benefits, including hospitalization, surgery, mental health services, prescription drugs, and so forth. In other words, the type of stuff you'd expect something called a healthcare policy to actually cover. ACA-compliant policies also have to cover at least 60% of those benefits. There's 4 metal levels available: bronze, silver, gold, or platinum, covering on average around 60, 70, 80, or 90% of your expenses. In addition, the ACA stripped away those annual or lifetime limits on claims, not just on the individual market, by the way, but for employer-provided coverage as well. Stack all of these up, and you get a one-legged stool. Now, a few states, particularly Washington and New York, had tried doing something like this in the past. They both required guaranteed issue, and New York State added community rating to their regulations. Unfortunately, this ended up being unstable. The one-legged stool tipped over for a simple reason: adverse selection. If anyone can sign up for coverage whenever they want to, and there's no negative consequence for not doing so, healthy people have a tendency to not bother signing up as long as they stay healthy, but then to do so the moment they're diagnosed with a serious ailment or they're seriously injured. This is like waiting until after you get into a car crash before signing up for auto insurance, or only signing up for homeowners insurance after your house catches on fire. That's why 48 states legally require auto insurance, And in the other two, you'll either have your license and registration suspended if you can't afford to pay for damages, or you'll have to pay a $500 penalty to not have it. Basically, the same thing as the ACA's individual mandate. And of course, it's next to impossible to get a mortgage without having homeowner's insurance. Anyway, without such a requirement, those who would be enrolled would end up being those more expensive to treat, which leads to higher premiums, which leads to more people who aren't terribly sick to drop coverage, which leads to higher premiums yet, and so on. This is known as the death spiral. To avoid this happening, when Mitt Romney, the then Republican governor of Massachusetts, signed RomneyCare into law, the individual market was set up as a three-legged stool, and the Affordable Care Act used this politically conservative model as well. The first leg, which I'll label in blue, covers the insurance carrier responsibilities, guaranteed issue, community rating, essential health benefits, minimum actuarial value, and no or annual or lifetime caps. Oh, and while they were at it, they also threw in a long list of free preventative services, including stuff like annual physicals, mammograms, blood screenings, and so on. The other two legs are the positive and negative incentives for people to enroll, or the carrot and the stick. The stick, in red, includes the enrollee responsibilities, which basically consists of actually having to sign up or have to pay a financial penalty if they don't, doing so within a limited period of time each year to prevent gaming the system, and of course actually paying their premiums. The limited open enrollment period has been 3 months for the past few years, but it's being cut in half to just 6 weeks for 2018. The carrot, in green, is the government's responsibilities. These mainly include providing a level playing field, financial assistance for those who require it, and financial protection to prevent people from going bankrupt in extreme situations. The level playing field is the ACA exchanges themselves, like healthcare.gov, Covered California, and so on. The financial assistance comes in the form of advanced premium tax credits for people earning between 100 to 400% of the federal poverty line, cost-sharing reduction assistance for helping with deductibles and copays for those earning between 100 and 250% of the poverty line, a cap on their maximum out-of-pocket expenses, beyond which the insurance company has to cover additional costs, and a requirement that at least 80% of the premium payments have to be used by the insurance company for actual healthcare expenses. This is called the 80-20 medical loss ratio, or the MLR rule. Okay, so that's what the three-legged stool was ideally supposed to look like. Unfortunately, in practice, it hasn't quite worked out that way. There are several problems with it, the biggest two of which are pretty obvious. First, the formula for the Advanced Premium Tax Credits, or APTC, turned out to simply not be generous enough. That 400% FPL income cap, which is around $48,000 for a single adult or $98,000 for a family of four, means that anyone earning even $1 over that goes from potentially thousands of dollars of assistance to nothing at all instantly. This is called the subsidy cliff, and it means that millions of middle-class people who earn too much for financial assistance also earn too little to be able to afford to pay full price. As a result, many of them have either avoided enrolling at all or were enrolled for a while, but then later dropped their coverage as rates increased, choosing to pay the mandate penalty instead. That brings me to the second problem. While it has had some effect in spurring people to enroll, the individual mandate penalty is, to be blunt, too small to be fully effective. $695 per adult, $348 per child, or 2.5% of the household income, whichever is larger. But the lowest cost plans available often cost considerably more than that for many people. If someone's faced with the option of paying, say, $3,000 per year for their insurance policy premiums, or a $700 penalty, many people see paying the penalty as saving $2,300, betting that they'll be healthy enough not to ever need that coverage for the next 12 months. Combined, these two problems mean that the three-legged stool actually looks like this. The solution to both of these problems is pretty obvious in theory. Raise or remove the 400% APTC cap and increase the mandate penalty. If you do both of these, millions of more people would sign up, which would reduce the uninsured rate even further, while also improving the risk pool, which in turn should stabilize the individual market and help lower premiums across the board. Now, let's be honest. Raising the mandate penalty is next to impossible politically, but at the very least, it shouldn't be eliminated. Unfortunately, eliminating it is exactly what congressional Republicans are now proposing. The irony is that both of the supposedly serious ACA replacement plans that they tried to shove through earlier this year included a replacement for the individual mandate, even as they pulverized the rest of the three-legged stool and avoided addressing the actual problems at hand. Last winter, the House Republicans came up with and passed the American Health Care Act, or AHCA. If it had become law, It would have officially kept the ACA's guaranteed issue and community rating rules, but it would have allowed state waivers to eliminate essential health benefits, minimum AV levels, brought back annual and lifetime caps, and might have even killed off free preventative services, although I was never quite sure about that one. It also would have appropriated funding for cost-sharing reductions for 2 years before eliminating it altogether. It then would have used state waivers to eliminate the cap on maximum out-of-pocket expenses and also would have killed off the 80% MLR rule. The AHCA would have kept premium tax credits, but it would have also completely restructured the formula, offering subsidies to those earning over 400%, which is good, but also making the subsidies far less generous for most people earning less than that, which is bad. Finally, the AHCA would have eliminated the individual mandate altogether, except not really, because it would have actually replaced it with a different type of financial penalty for not getting covered, a 30% surcharge on premiums for a 12-month period if and when the person did get around to actually enrolling. Oh, and that money would actually go directly to the insurance company's coffers, not the federal government, which I'm not even sure would be legal or logistically enforceable. Many insurance experts are pretty sure that this would have actually been less effective than the current mandate penalty, while simultaneously being more draconian, since the only ones who would end up paying the surcharge would be those who were the most desperate for coverage at that moment. This is what the stool would have looked like if the AHCA had passed. Needless to say, this would not have solved the ACA's problems. Then, the Senate Republicans came up with their replacement plan, called the, and I'm not making this up, Better Care Reconciliation Act Plan, or BCRAP, seriously. BCRAP would have devastated the blue leg and green leg pretty much the same way as the AHCA would have. The premium tax credits would have been kept here as well, but they would have again been restructured to be far stingier for those currently receiving them, and would have actually lowered the income threshold from 400% to 350% of the federal poverty line. As for the individual mandate, it would again have been replaced, this time with a 6-month lockout period. This would have meant that if you didn't have coverage in, say, January 2020, not only would you have to wait until November 2020 to enroll, your coverage wouldn't even start until July of 2021, which means in theory you could go up to 18 months without coverage. Again, this is what BCRAP would have looked like if it had become law. Congressional Republicans also threw in a couple of other variants. There was the Obamacare Repeal Reconciliation Act, or ORA. Yes, it actually would have used the word Obamacare in the title, which would have gone back to the one-legged stool, keeping all of the carrier requirements, but stripping away both the red and green legs altogether. Then there was the Healthcare Freedom Act, known as Skinny Repeal, which would have eliminated CSR assistance and the mandate penalty only, leaving the rest as is. I'll come back to this in a bit. And of course, in late September, they tried a Hail Mary play called Graham Cassidy, which I believe ended up looking something like this. Thankfully, every one of these eventually fell apart, but it also left the ACA individual market right back where it started, with the tax credits not provided to enough people, and the mandate penalty not quite strong enough to be properly effective. Then, on October 13th, Donald Trump officially pulled the plug on CSR reimbursement payments. CSRs were still part of the ACA, mind you, but due to a federal lawsuit brought on by congressional Republicans themselves a few years earlier, Trump, who had been threatening to do so for months, finally decided to go ahead and stop the monthly payments cold. Trump thought that this would destroy the already somewhat shaky ACA exchanges while deliberately hurting millions of low-income enrollees who rely on CSR assistance. But a funny thing happened instead. You see, unlike APTC assistance, which is paid to the insurance company by the government before the upcoming month, CSR assistance is actually paid out by the carriers to the doctors and hospitals first, and then the government reimburses them for their expenses the following month. Trump did not stop the CSR assistance provided by the carriers. He stopped them from being paid back afterwards. Yes, that's right. Donald Trump has started stiffing contractors who kept up their side of the bargain in good faith. Shocking, I know. But the thing is, the insurance companies are contractually required to keep providing that CSR help, even if they're never paid back for doing so. This left them with two options. One, they could drop out of the individual market altogether, which is what some of them actually have done. Or, two, they can jack up their premiums through the roof to make sure that they don't have to eat the CSR costs no matter what. One way or the other, they're making sure that they will get their money. So, most carriers ended up raising their premiums an additional 15 or 20% or so beyond what they normally would have to cover the CSR difference. But here's the thing. When premiums increase, so do the premium subsidies. If the benchmark silver plan goes up 50%, then the tax credits also go up by about 50% to match for most people. The long story short, APTC assistance increased to fill most of the gap left by the CSR cutoff, and in fact made the APTC more generous for millions of people. But it also made the full price premium even worse for those over 400% of the poverty line. That brings me to the latest atrocity being pulled by the Congressional Republicans, the tax bill. Along with a whole bunch of other horrible stuff, most of which doesn't have anything to do with the ACA, one thing they're trying to push through is simply repealing the individual mandate by itself without replacing it with anything at all. If this looks similar to the skinny bill which failed this summer, it is. That would have killed off CSRs and the mandate, and Trump has already taken care of the first half of the job, so that just leaves the mandate. If you eliminate the mandate, coverage loss estimates range from around 3 to 5 million, according to Standard & Poor's, to as many as 13 million, according to the Congressional Budget Office, with the adverse selection impact jacking up prices by another 10% or so. The truth is, there's no way of knowing for sure how many people would lose coverage, because one other big unknown is how the insurance carriers will react. Many of them have stated point blank that they'll simply pull up stakes and leave the individual market altogether if the mandate is repealed without an acceptable incentive replacement. It doesn't matter how high your tax credits go if there's no one to buy insurance from. Again, most of this nonsense and insanity could be avoided if the GOP would simply agree to at least raise or remove the 400% FPL cap, which actually was a bill already introduced in the Senate back in June by half dozen Democratic senators. Which, of course, Congressional Republicans will never do. Which is where things stand today. Anyway, I'm Charles Gaba of ACASignups.net. If you'd like to support my work on an ongoing basis, please become a patron at patreon.com/charlesgaba, or if you'd like to make a one-time donation, you can do so at gofundme.com/ACASignups. Thanks.